أرنا من يهديه الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبد الله ورسوله إمام المتقين ورسول رب العالمين الذي بعث إلى الأحمر والأسود والذي تركنا على المحجة البيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك صلى الله وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. أما بعد, my beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, it is indeed a very great day, the day of Friday, within the days of the months of Hajj, where the pilgrims who have intended to make Hajj this year, some of them have left and some of them shall leave shortly. We ask the Almighty to grant us all goodness and ease. Brothers and sisters, it is important that I remind myself and yourself to be conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is only through the consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we will be saved from the calamities of this world and the next. More importantly, the calamities of the grave and thereafter. We ask the Almighty to grant us ease the day He takes us away. Brothers and sisters, we have been created in this world not so that we can achieve whatever we want and we desire in this world, but so that we follow the plan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a way that when we arrive in paradise, we will then be able to achieve whatever we desire. So anyone who follows his or her whims and fancies in this world shall perhaps be prohibited from achieving what they desire in paradise. That is, if they make it there, may Allah grant us paradise. Ameen. But it is important for us to know that those who block themselves from following their desires, whims and fancies that are in contradiction to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed or sent down, for them there is good news that they will be granted the eternal bliss and goodness. So to control yourself for a few years in this temporary world is in fact the duty that Allah has placed upon us. It is part of the test that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen for us to go through. He made us and He created us. And He says very clearly that He has tested us in order for us to worship Him alone and for us to pass that particular test by His will. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. He says, I have not created mankind nor jinnkind except that they may worship me. Which means we owe our worship to Allah alone. We will worship Him, none but Him, nobody with Him. Neither a stick nor a stone, nor a human being, nor a saint, nor a grave. We worship Allah alone. We worship Allah alone. That is the test. And from this we realize that if that is the main test, then Shaytan's plan would be such that he would come to try and deviate us in this particular matter primarily. And this is why it is very important for us to check our lives on a daily basis. Whom am I worshipping? Do I worship my Maker alone, or do I worship the other creatures of Allah? Do I worship my wealth? Do I worship my children, my family members? Whom do I worship? Worship is solely and only for the one who made me, the one who made you. May he grant us goodness and forgiveness. Amen. May he grant us steadfastness as well. Amen. In life, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it very clear to us that we will not get everything we want. If I wish for something, Allah said, did not guarantee that I will have it in this world. Part of my faith is to surrender to the decree of the Almighty. When he has chosen something for me or against me, and I need to know al-qadr, which means the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is part of my iman, part of my faith. If, for example, something happens around me that I did not want to happen, the test is how do I react to it? How do I feel about it? Am I in contentment with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Do I understand that it is an opportunity for me to gain closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? I can give you a few typical examples. Point number one. Sometimes a person accomplished so much in terms of wealth. And mashallah, they find a job and they begin to work. And after some time, they lose that job. And they lose a lot of money. Sometimes they suffer loss because something burnt down, or because accidentally or through an accident, someone passed away. That was no coincidence. That was in the plan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not guarantee that because you have such a high qualification, you are definitely going to be a wealthy person. Some people have high qualifications, they cannot find jobs. Some people have a lot of money, they have no happiness. Some people have a lot of wealth, but they don't have health. Some people have beautiful homes, but their children perhaps may be disobedient. All these tests from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should make us better people. One of the plans of Allah is that these tests will draw us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not further away. But sometimes people suffer a loss. Say an examination you are trying to achieve from so long, and you sit the exam once, twice, thrice, and you keep on failing. Remember, that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's plan for you. Work as hard as you can, leave the rest in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sometimes we lose our job because we are Muslim. Sometimes people look at us with the eye of prejudice because perhaps our name is Islamic, or the way we dress is Muslim, or the fact that they know we are Muslim. How do we react to that? Do we become hooligans? Do we behave in a way that is not befitting Islam and the Muslims? Or do we surrender to the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and try to do something positive in order, to change the mindset of people as best as we can regarding Islam and the Muslims, so that the same will not be repeated with our brothers and sisters? Sometimes we react spontaneously. We become angry and agitated to the degree that we don't realize the way we react to something Allah has chosen to put in our lives is very, very unbefitting of a Muslim. And it does more harm than good. So we need to calm ourselves. We need to make sure we ponder with sound intellect. Go back to the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and learn from his sunnah how calm he was, how he reacted to things that happened. He lost his children, how did he react? He lost property, well, how did he react? He had people who came to fight him, how did he react? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all steadfastness and goodness. So it's important for us to realize that in life, the more Allah loves you, the greater He shall test you. As the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ إِذَا أَحَبَّ عَبْدًا إِبْتَلَاهُ. When Allah loves a worshipper, He tests him. And He tests him more because عِظَمُ الْأَجْرِ مَعَ عِظَمِ الْإِبْتِلَاهُ. The greater the test, or the greater reward is with the greater test. When Allah has chosen so many tests for you, you need to know that is preparing your paradise, for as long as you react to those tests in a way that will please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam lost his son Ibrahim, whilst he was in his hands, and he says, we will not utter words of displeasure, but we say to Allah is what He has taken, and for Him was what He gave us in the first place. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a lesson from that. Brothers and sisters, in this life, some people want to marry a particular person and they close their eyes on that particular person to the degree that if they don't marry them, they become depressed and they lose the world. But they don't realize, subhanAllah, perhaps Allah has not planned that for you. Perhaps your test is to surrender to the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You may not have exactly what you want, but Allah knows that you will get what you want in the Akhirah if you have surrendered to the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this particular dunya. We have so many issues of people who are unhappy in this world, yet they are Muslimin. The two do not come together. If you are a Muslim, you are happy. If you are unhappy, there is something wrong with your iman. Because Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam speaks to us. And he says so beautifully in a hadith that we should be knowing off by heart, عَجَبًا لِأَمْرِ الْمُؤْمِنِ فَإِنَّ أَمْرَهُ كُلَّهُ لَهُ خَيْرٌ. Amazing are the affairs of a true believer, for indeed all his affairs are good. They are all good. If something good happens to him, he is thankful, so it's good for him. And if something evil befalls him, or if he does not get exactly what he wants as he wants it, he bears patience. He understands it's the test of Allah. And he understands the nature of this world, this dunya, its nature is that I'm never ever going to get every single thing I want. From 100 things, I might get 10 things, I might get 20 things. I thank Allah. The other 80, and perhaps multiplied so much, I will get in the akhirah, in the hereafter, in paradise. But I need to surrender to what Allah has not given me in this world, surrender to His decree in order for me to get to the akhirah. This is something of utmost importance, because too many people are suffering because iman is weak. We don't understand the plan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with us. And sometimes we don't even understand how to react to what's happening around us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us sound knowledge. Amen. May He make us from those who love one another for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Amen. Today, we want people to think exactly how we think. Otherwise, this man is not a Muslim. This man is a deviant. This man is this. This man is that. But no two people think alike. That we don't understand. Yes, we should discuss when it comes to bringing people towards what is right. Towards what Allah has revealed, we discuss inshallah based on sound knowledge, and at the same time realizing and understanding the gift of Allah to have allowed such a discussion. But if we were taught to just label and stay far away from this man because his eyes are slightly different from mine in that particular case, we will only be spreading complete and utter destruction in the ummah, because we will be splitting ourselves into small little groups, not understanding that we are part of one major ummah. We will always discuss matters with knowledge and sound knowledge, and we will always try to bring ourselves together, bearing in mind that difference of opinion has been there from the time of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum all the way down. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. It is important that I spend a few moments to make mention of the sacrifice in Islam. When we say sacrifice, one of the prime issues that come to our minds, the sacrifice of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, of his son Ismail, may peace be upon them all and upon us. If we take a look at what happened, according to the narrations, the historic narrations and some of the ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, it was a dream, an instruction to a Nabi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, to do something that pleased Allah, although it did not make sense to this man. But he knew it was coming from Allah, so whether it made sense or not was besides the point. I have to get this fulfilled because it is wahi, it is revelation, it is from Allah, it is an instruction of my Maker. Here it is, and I will get this fulfilled. He was instructed to sacrifice his son. The upbringing of that particular son was such that when he spoke to the son says, Ya abati fa'al ma tu'mar, O my father, do as you have been instructed. Satajiduni insha'allahu min as-sabirin. You will find me being from amongst those who are patient. This was the upbringing of the child. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to give our children similar upbringing, that when the decree of Allah is mentioned to them, they do not find it difficult to surrender to it. Today, we don't read salah and we expect our children to read salah. We don't dress appropriately and we are saddened when our children dress more indecently than us. So, there are two ways.